want to thank Tyler for that incredible introduction. I invited him and several other young entrepreneurs to come and visit with me at the White House, and we had a really very long and important conversation about the future of America. And Tyler, you represent the best of our future. Thank you for that. And please give it up for Quavo and Megan. So it is so good to see everyone. And let me also thank our incredible members of Congress who are with us this evening. Senator John Ossoff. Representative Nakima Williams, to Mayor Andre Dickens, thank you for welcoming me back to Atlanta, and thank you to the great Stacey Abrams for your extraordinary leadership. So, Georgia, it is so good to be back, and I am very clear. The path to the White House runs right through this state. And you all helped us win in 2020, and we're going to do it again in 2024. Yes, we will. Yes, we will.
Who? Man. Where do I begin? Where do I begin? Guys, thanks for tuning in, man. Checking this out. This new video here. Finally get a chance to get some content back on this channel. I got to talk. And what I got to talk about and give my, I'm going to give my 2 cents on it because it's got something. And if you guys want to hear my opinion, this is what my whole channel is going to be about anyway. My reaction to different things that I see. And it includes things in the political world as well. If you guys saw me when I talked on LFR, shout out to Van. Still watching your stuff, brother. Keep doing what you do. Love your stuff, man. Love your content. Love to get back on with you again another day here soon. Be nice. And we can talk some more. What I need to talk about, man, is Kamala Harris. This has been a thing that's kind of, what, as we say, stuck in my crawl for about 4 years, 4.5 years. And I say this because... excuse me, when she decided to run for the presidential nominee for the Democrat Party back in 2020, this was put out into the air and people were talking about the simple fact that Kamala Harris could possibly be the first black woman president then, okay? Knowing for the longest time since she was attorney general in California, and then elected into the Senate, being the first Indian woman elected into the Senate, coming out of California. I questioned her then. I was like, wait a minute. If you're Indian, how are you all of a sudden now a black woman, running as a black woman? I need to understand this, okay? So then, you know, I dug into it a little later. They kept talking about it. I'm like, this woman's not black, man, okay? All right. I'm just saying. Back then, called it out. Nobody said anything, you know, or whatever. You know, like I said, it was put out in the air, whatever. Talked to friends of mine and stuff. We all talk politics and stuff like that. I said it back then. So this woman's not black. She's not, okay? I just know she's not black. Dig into it some more, start digging into her family. Her family history. Now, I want to clear the air because I know when I was on Van's show, I said... that I knew for a fact that her father was mixed. I knew he was mixed. I knew he was half Irish. It's like I said, at the time talking to Van, you know, I had so much going through my head here as we were talking about it, but I knew he was half Irish. I knew he was mixed. And I knew he was born in Jamaica. So I remember it. Okay. I need to clear it up some more, get some more detail to it. He's half Irish, half East Indian as well. Okay. This, as I said, I knew she was mixing. Her mother is 100% East Indian. Now, let's set the record straight once and for all, because the media is in a buzz now over Donald Trump making a comments here at the NABJ the national, what is that, the National Association for Black Journalists, that he agreed to go to on that. And you're hearing all of the media here, man. This is like, I'm going to have to do another video on that as well, because that was some bull crap, man, that come out of, what's his name, the girl, the lady that was sitting right next to him, okay? How they even ran that thing, how it was, and then how they treated him. The girl right here, Harris Faulkner, she did the best she could. Okay, I know she did, and they put her down on the far end, and somehow she had some technical issues where she could hardly hear him. Trump could hardly hear her, but he couldn't avoid hearing the one that was sitting right next to him in his ear, just what the wokest bull crap and just her attitude of how she treated him, which was unbelievably ridiculous. But I digress. Like I said, let's get back to this video here. Guys, I'm talking about Judge Joe Brown. You know what? This may seem, it might seem like his gossip, possibly, to some. To me, it does not seem like it's gossip, because I say this is because the fact that Joe Brown was out there in California and said he was doing his show. Now, he is a legitimate judge. It's no joke, okay? The man also, you don't think he's got connections to, and he says he knows this woman. So he knows who she is. Even though you see him as gossipy, it's like he heard this and that. He's dealt with her, okay? He's had to deal with it at least a few times or so, at least, out of this and pick up this whole deal about this woman. So I was blown away. Why? Because he exposed so much about how much of a fraud this woman is. And I say this is because black folks, you are constantly, black folks, constantly getting played. You're constantly getting played with your emotions. This is why some black folks are bent out of shape, all in arms about the simple fact calling her out, saying this woman's not black. I've been saying this, she's not black. Stop calling her black. Okay? She's not. I'm going to tell you what, man. Here, let's do this. And let's hear Judge Joe Brown speak on this here. And stick with me and watch this.
But I got to ask you about Kamala Harris. How you feel about her?
She's a piece of shit. I was in California. She lacked professional competence, and she worked on it by hiking up her hemline when she needed influence rather than researching. I was out in California for 15 years doing my show when she was at her peak, and she had a reputation amongst the trial lawyers of being lazy. She'd just hike her skirt up and try to flirt, and she wasn't that good in the courtroom, if not pretty bad in the courtroom. So I'm not surprised at what she does. She's 60 years old, and I think listening to her word salad and the way she talks, I think she's got early onset dementia and also some problems with menopausal complications. That's that, you see, today is going to be tomorrow. So since it's going to be tomorrow, today we have tomorrow, which is why we are now. Like, what did you say?
Exactly.
They have something in mind, but they cannot cognate getting all the way through it, which is why she's famous for this word salad garbage, and she doesn't make a bit of sense. I think since she's only 60, she's actually on a worse track than Biden was. Biden is 20-some years older than her, and he has been senile for a long time. Now, about 5 or 6 years ago, when did they start ramping up to do this?
Right.
2019? Okay. Right. I was saying Biden has been a failure his whole adult career.
Let me pause him right there. What he said about Biden, he's right, because if you remember back 5 years ago, almost 6 years ago, we were calling him out. Us conservatives, anybody else was watching, we were calling Biden out then, before he even announced the fact that he said he was going to run for the presidency. We called him out and said, dude, he's starting to slip. And the media was blowing it up. Oh, no, it's just typical Joe Biden. These are just gaffes that come out of Joe Biden. He does this all the time, yada, yada, yada. Bullcrap, man. We get the gaffes. I get that. We understand that. Yes, he's done that throughout his career. I understand that. But he was doing some other stuff, and we start getting suspect about it. I said, these ain't gaffes, man. These ain't gaffes about Joe Biden. He was starting to slip. like I said, about 5-6 years ago, was suspect of him then. And then when it got to 2020 even more, start noticing even more start coming up. All here is the whole time. Now you see.
A second-rate, third-string player. He's in the game, so he wants to make a name for himself. I considered him for years poor trailer park, urban trailer park trash. And he's a crook.
Yes.
He's a third stringer. Now, what I said he was going to do is he probably wants to claim fame for being the first person to see to it that a woman got to be president. And what I predicted, I'm slightly wrong on it, was that he was going to get in, try to get elected, and if he got one term, try to get elected for a second one. And then halfway through his term, when he had served 2 years, to retire or resign in her favor. So under the 22nd Amendment, what happens is she can serve for the final 2 years for somebody and then be elected twice more.
Exactly.
So that woman would be able to serve 10 years, second only to Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who got elected to four terms before they put the amendment in place.
Exactly.
That said, I think, and my major at UCLA was political science. My analysis was, is they picked the weakest somebody they could as a figurehead, somebody who had some apparent minority status, which she does not. And what goes on is that...
Outside of her being a woman and East Indian of heritage, that's about as close as you're going to get as far as it calling it out as a minority.
You get her, everybody that is everybody would be afraid to go against her because of what she can pass herself off as. And then you get somebody that's easy to control because she's lazy, because she is becoming incoherent, and because she's always tried to do the casting couch to get where she wants. Now, the problem is that'll get somebody to a certain level quickly.
Exactly. And if you think it's gossip, why don't you ask Slick Willie Brown over there in San Francisco? Everybody know about that.
But you can't get past that level if you don't have competence and talent. So my thing about it is if I'm crude about it, in this city years ago, I used to represent a whole bunch of pimps and hoes, and I know a hoe when I see one. And I say this, I don't care, women, you do what you want to do if you want to have recreational sex, but when you do the casting couch or anything else for professional purposes to get paid or advance, you a hoe. And she's old hoe. And the problem is what is she supposed to do? Somebody, one of her sycophant slaves comes up and unwraps her in a carpet naked at Putin's feet, and he says, oh, yeah, I'm Julius Caesar. He said, no, I got better stuff here already. Plus, I don't want you anyway, you old woman. Get on up, you know.
And I got to admit, man, Joe Brown makes me laugh, dude. He has for a long time. I've known, watched this dude for a lot of years. When he had his show and everything else like that back then, dude, Joe Brown was awesome. He was one of my favorites, you know. When you get a chance to pull back when he had his show years ago. Man, I'm telling you, it was good stuff, boy. God, he used to make me laugh back then.
Xi Jinping, is he supposed to be impressed? She's doing word salad. Well, we're here today because China and the U.S. are here today, and that's why we have to agree on what we are doing here today. Like, fool, what did you just say? You know, did you say anything?
No, she just said something similar to some crap like that just the other day. Talking about Joe Biden again. Same crap, word salad. Just like, what?
And I've never seen such a salacious mess as I've seen out of her. I think a One West Bank. I had some pretty good properties out in California at one point in time. And I know I had three neighbors who had good properties. It was in a place called Ojai, California. And they got caught up about 15, 16 years ago, like a lot of people did, in that mortgage bundling scam stuff that was going on. And there was a bank called One West Bank responsible for it, which was owned by George Soros. The Mnuchin that you have out of the Obama administration was Mnuchin, who was the CEO of One West Bank. Well, there were approximately 1,200 counts of indictments returned against Mnuchin and One West Bank in various counties in California.
Okay, listen to what he's saying about this, because Kamala Harris, this is some crap she was involved in directly in this. Pay attention to what he's saying.
Well, Mnuchin and Soros financed and arranged and sponsored Kamala to run for Attorney General of California. They got her elected. She got in, and using the authority she had, she promptly consolidated all 5,200 counts and dismissed them. And a couple of weeks later, Soros sold One West Bank for $4.2 billion. So after that, they got together and got her finance and got everything organized and made the connections for her, and she got elected to U.S. Senator. Willie Brown made the initial contacts and arrangements so she could get elected as district attorney for San Francisco.
Slick Willie Brown. I got something to say about that, too.
She didn't do a very good job. She had a reputation for giving out the stiffest sentences in the United States of America for simple possession of marijuana San Francisco, for God's sakes.
True fact.
But it was only to young black men. She's not a parent, never had any children, but she went off on this campaign to lock parents up, some of whom actually were shown to have dropped their children off at the school, but they played hooky, so she was putting them in jail.
And that's another thing, too, that bugs the hell out of me, too. Why is it that some women, and when you hear Kamala talking about it's an attack on women's reproductive rights, and this is like, first of all, you're not a mother. You're a stepmother, but you're not a mother. You have not birthed a child yet. So that whole abortion issue, man, like I said, that's just opening up a can of worms. But honestly, it was put back right. It was back to the state. Okay, this BS about talking about how the GOP is taking away your right to an abortion. It's like, they're not talking about a national ban on it, which I know some rhinos or whatever are talking about it. Some of them, you know, it's just like, look, the Supreme Court turned it back to the states where it started, where it should have never left to begin with back in 1973. Should have never left. All right. Put it back to the states. People, you don't understand, or I should say ladies, you don't understand that this is the first time in 50-something years, what, since 73 till now, okay? This is the first time that a law has been overturned, reversed back, and given power back to the people. Do you understand? You are stronger with your voice at the local, state, then federal. 1, 2, 3. That's how that works. If you understand anything about government, this is one damn thing you should get down and understand. You have more power at the local, then state, then federal. But some people get it twisted around, think it's the other way. It's like, no. If you put it back in the states, it's easier to hold your state representative, your governor, and everything. It's easier to hold them accountable on how you vote that way than it is at the federal level. So like I said, being turned back to the states, that's where this is, like I said, the first time in my life I've ever seen a government give up power and give it back. Because that don't happen. That does not happen. When the government takes it, they sure as hell ain't giving it back. Okay? That's the first time I've ever seen that in my life because of that ruling. But somehow, you know, ignorant liberals are just pissed off about it because now the government doesn't have an umbrella over the simple fact of abortion. So now, like I said before, ladies, I know you're pissed off because you just can't run around the hood over in the corner there and get it taken care of. Now you got to plan a road trip to kill your baby. Okay. You can still get it done, ladies. You just can't get it done at your convenience. I'll shut up about that right now.
I know my in-laws, now late in-laws, because they're dead, and their fine daughter that I was married to, we were divorced. She got a whole lot of money, but anyway, out of me. What wound up happening was there was a liquor store they liked to patronize on the way home, and it was a good liquor store, but it got held up a lot, so Kamala's solution was not go get the crooks, but Kroll closed down the liquor store so nobody would be troubled by it. See, that kind of philosophy, or you've got a serial killer who's got six victims, and the families are writing protest letters to her, not hurry up and do something, not why are you giving the guy such a light deal, is why don't you let this man plead guilty to life without parole instead of delaying it for 7 years,
yeah,
trying to make political hay out of it. I was caught up in a thing where this woman who was supposed to be a financial specialist wound up embezzling a lot, $1.5 million from me, about $15 million from some other black celebrities. And most of it was in the San Francisco area, not LA where I was. She consolidated the cases up there in San Francisco, took 5 years to resolve it. Let her plead out not the $15 million of embezzlement, but $35,000. The sentence was 5 years in the penitentiary, 4.5 years suspended, 5 years probation. The woman wound up sitting on a bench outside Sybil Branch, which is the women's detention facility in L.A. County, for 5.5 hours. That's all the time she served, made no restitution. And la-di-da, I'm through with it now. I don't care on her behalf. Like, where is our money? You know, what did you do here? You didn't even consult with us. You did this on a surprise basis. That's $15 million gone. What happened?
Right.
It's the kind of thing she would do, see?
Yeah. Like, so where the hell is our money?
It's like, that was not a good professional performance. And then she was everybody's favorite Hindu Indian prosecutor and attorney general and senator, and now she becomes black.
Now you're getting into the meat and potatoes of this whole thing. Pay attention to this, seriously. And set the damn record straight about this woman. And then after this, I'm done with it.
But, you know, I met her daddy, fine gentleman, Professor Harris. And the problem with her being black is Professor Harris says he's Caucasian, mixed Irish and Hindu. He doesn't have any black ancestors, but his Irish ancestors owned a lot of slaves in Jamaica.
There you go.
And had them to work on plantation. So if mama is on the birth certificate listed as a Caucasian, daddy says he's a Caucasian Hindu and has no black ancestors, how did she get to be black?
Thank you.
Now, a little side story.
Check this out.
When I had my show, let's say this has been 26 years ago,
mm-hmm,
I had two beautiful women that I thought were sisters on the show. And they laughed one time when we all went to a happy hour and said, "You think we're black, don't you?" "Yeah, aren't you?" "No, we're Hindu." One of them said, "My mother's a Hindu Brahmin caste. My father was Hindu warrior caste. He took an oath to the family to protect her. They fell in love, eloped, and now we got a death warrant on us. We can't go back to India." So, yeah. And then they gave me two books. The guys were Hindu, and they were very dark, but they cut their hair off close, grew beards, and started dressing and acting black, and they got financial aid. One of them, I think, went through medical school that way, masquerading for being black. Somebody else did it, so she went to Howard. And by the way, she told one big lie when she was talking about she got bust because of something Biden did when she was running against him.
Listen,
well, the yearbook that she put out there that you can still get online from her high school in Canada shows she went from kindergarten through 12th grade in Canada, never went to school in the United States of America.
Hmm. that's strange. Her tell a lie? I don't know. Maybe it also fits along with her ethnicity, too. Her claiming to be black. Another lie. She's a fraud.
She was born, by the way, in the same hospital that my ex-wife was born in, the same 12-month period. And my late mother-in-law was, in fact, a pediatric nurse in that hospital when Kamala was born. And the birth certificate that she has is interesting because the confusion comes from a mistake. On the birth certificate, it lists the mother's race as Caucasian, national origin India, and religion Hindu. For the father, it does not list national origin. It does not list religion. It does not list anything about that, but where it says race, they put national origin in Jamaica by mistake. Now, if you've ever been to Jamaica and you go over to St. Elizabeth Parish, you see all the high, bright, and white that live in Jamaica. So I've got a good friend retired from law enforcement. He has a white wife, blonde haired, blue eyes, but she was born in Jamaica. Her parents were born in Jamaica. One's blonde and blue eyed. The other one's red haired and gray eyed. And they happen to be related to the King of England because they are aristocrats. And
let me pause it right there. And he's right. And this is the thing. I don't know where you got your education from, but this is some stuff that basically from high school that I learned. So like I said, I'm not knocking your education where you got it from. All I'm saying is we knew this. If you study anything about Jamaica, this is just a little quick trip into history about Jamaica. Basically, when Great Britain colonized Jamaica back in 1707, okay? Then it became Crown Colony, which is Royal Colony back in 1866. They didn't gain their independence from all of that until 1962, but Jamaica is still under British Commonwealth, still to this day. It has its independence, but it's still under the Commonwealth of Great Britain. So what does that mean? He's going to explain this because, like I said, I knew this. Matter of fact, I knew this and studied. I knew I did study back in school. I went back and refreshed my memory because I've been out of school for quite some time. So I went back and refreshed my memory and remembered exactly it, what we studied. He's going to explain it here, and he's 100% right.
In England, but they were born in Jamaica. So if you go over there, you see people from Hong Kong, Singapore, New Zealand, Australia, Kenya, South Africa, you name it. It's part of the British Commonwealth, and nobody needed a passport, and you could just go in and out.
Right.
So it's not unusual. You're not black just because you are from Jamaica, and they have a whole lot of white people that never left, and their ancestors owned a lot of slaves.
There you
go. The Maroons went up into the hill country and got themselves free back in the 1840s. But, you know, other than that, it is what it is in Jamaica.
He's right. He's right. You can look this up. Pull it right up. It's true. Still. So like I said, when somebody says Jamaica, don't automatically assume that somebody's black that's from Jamaica. It's like, no, there's other races there that's born in Jamaica. Not necessarily black. Okay.
So just because you are from that country does not mean you are of the black race. So the problem is why don't you go get your daddy to give you an affidavit that you have a black ancestor? And since the only possible claim you have is through your great-grandmother, who he says was a Hindu house servant that just happens to be swarthy, where'd you get your blackness from?
You're
faking it again.
There you go.
And I say this after 50 years of experience. The worst human beings you will ever find are career prosecutors. Something slimy about them. They are so turned off by humanity and everything else. They don't care. They're trying to win the game. It is just play to them. They don't give a damn about the people they represent. They just want to win. So they lie, cheat, steal to win the game.
That's why, you know, I've said for years and, you know, jokingly saying, if you're looking for an attorney, just dial 1-800-DIRTBAG. There you go.
And that brings up the other thing, where the Supreme Court of California ordered her to produce the evidence that was exculpating to somebody sitting up on death row that she had hidden.
That's right. Tulsi Gabbard ripped Kamala, crushed her on that debate stage. If you remember back in 2020 on a debate stage, or 2019 on the debate stage, when Tulsi Gabbard went right at Kamala and brought that up right there. And that whole thing, when she laid into Kamala about her record, that was pretty much it. You got to remember, this woman is sitting here right now. She's nominated as the Democrat presidential candidate right here. And this woman hasn't received a vote yet. So explain this to me. Democrats, do you see how you're being screwed to your face when Democrat Party comes out and says, well, this is all about democracy? Explain democracy, because it's not democracy. It's all about power and control. We know this by now, okay? We should have known this by years. I've known it for years because it's all they stand on. But yet they want to come out and tell you right to your face and gaslight you and tell you that this is all about democracy. This is the reason why we have to do this way. It's like, you know, you just pissed and crapped in your party's face, the ones, your voters that vote for you, talking about democracy, yet you didn't let them practice their democracy and have an open convention, which you can't now, I don't think, because Joe Biden endorsed her for presidency. That's another, this whole coup where people are just cooing and sticking each other back and forth. So now you're stuck with her, and you're stuck with a woman that nobody voted for. She bowed out of that race, man, before they went to the Iowa caucus, before they even thought about casting a vote for her. So she didn't get one for any, no delegates at all from the state. She didn't get any votes from that. She bowed out. She was done. Then next thing you know, she's running on a ticket with Joe Biden because, yes, she's a DEI hire because he said it had to be a woman, it had to be a woman of color, and he's looking more for a black woman to be. And she was only one. So he picked her, scooped her up, because that's what Democrats do. They play ideological politics with everybody else. So it's insane, man. It's insane.
They did that over and over and over again with her hiding this evidence. Now, there are exceptions to this rule with career prosecutors, but if you ever want a sleazy somebody, find yourself a career prosecutor who's never done anything else but that until they have moved up. Now, there have been people like Thomas Dewey, who was a career prosecutor. He got Lucky Luciano, the gangster that set up the mob as a syndicate, a business. He got him and became governor of New York and then an unsuccessful candidate for president twice. You have people like that, and you got Kamala, who was a career prosecutor. And that's essentially all she's done outside of moving directly over into politics. They tend to be crooks. They're not good people. It's like I used to, on the bench, it's like, excuse me, can you approach... both of you, do you have any character? Do you realize what you just did? Well, I mean, no, we can't have that. That is not going to be allowed up in here. You do it again, and the court's going to see to it that you get a 10-day paid vacation courtesy of the sheriff.
Mm-hmm.
No.
No, that means.
Uh-uh. See, and that's what I'm looking at. She wants to be chief administrative officer, but she's never been the boss over anything. She was nominally with the attorney general's office, but you've got all of these egos with all of these people with doctorate of laws who've taken the bar exam, and every one of them in there could run against you in an election and be your boss,
mm-hmm.
and is as qualified technically as you are to run the place.
Mm-hmm.
So she's never been the boss in charge of something where she dictated, because what she did in San Francisco and when she got over California is she essentially had somebody else doing it, and she was just a political figurehead. So when you come into this situation here, Putin, you know, Russia, Ukraine, those are serious things. They have a lot of nukes. You've got Xi Jinping, and China's got one hell of a huge army, Air Force, nukes, computer systems, and so on. What is your experience in international diplomacy?
And this is the damn question that people need to ask this woman, the state media is too focused on a comment that Donald Trump made at that interview, like I said, which was a BS interview by them people that put that on, okay? And Trump is just, that's my dog right there. I'm telling you, that's my dog. He went into it, knew he was going into the lion's den, as we say. He knew. But the thing about it is, and then he called him out for the bullcrap they pulled. They held him up 30 minutes, 35 minutes, you know. And he's only scheduled for an hour to give him an hour an interview. They claim it was a technical issue with the audio. He still gets out there when he comes out there and they finally get it fired off, you know, CPT time, of course, half hour late. So when they finally get the thing fired up, he goes into it and the woman comes right off the rip, man, just being rude as hell with that woke BS crap, man. And I was like, oh, dude, let me keep talking, Joe.
You got made the representative of the country to handle the foreign affairs. You failed so badly they yanked you out when you were actually the boss in charge. The borders are, you just complete abject failure to that. Your only appearance down there was to sit in a chair in the desert while they interviewed you trying to be cute.
And Trump's pointed that out at the fact that she was at the wrong part of the border. Same thing with AOC when she did that BS photo op when she went to the border wall too. Yeah, okay. Come on now. This woman is straight garbage.
Flashing your pearls, you know, and you didn't do your job.
No.
So you're talking now about you want to legitimize 20 million aliens who've come in here and see that they get fast-tracked so they can vote and become part of the whole process. What are you doing?
That's what they want to do.
Whose jobs are you taking away?
Black jobs first. The ones that all of you woke liberals over here talking about. Oh, yeah, Donald Trump talking about my black job, you know. What does he mean by black jobs? Figure it out, idiots. Figure it out. Black jobs that you would normally get, okay, if you don't have a degree, if you don't have any skill, if you don't have really pretty much anything to bring to the table, so you get an entry-level work, which is quite a few jobs. It's a lot of jobs, honestly, to tell you the truth. I can't break the percentage off of you, too, but, yeah, most likely they're entry work jobs. I mean, waitress, janitorial stuff, cleanup, housekeeping, anything else like that. These are entry-level jobs, okay? Very, very, very easy to get. Whose job do you think is in jeopardy, man, with almost 20 million illegals coming in here to fast-track, give them work permits, give them mass amnesty, because if they give them work permits to work, then you start digging into the Constitution, because I tell you, Democrats are going to come up and say, hey, well, you know, we gave them work permits and stuff and we got to tax them for the money. But, you know, they can't have taxation without representation because that's in the Constitution. So what? I mean, in order to get representation for it, somehow we got to fast track, give them mass amnesty and give them citizenship in order to make it legal. I guarantee that's going to be the argument that comes up. Black folks, wake the hell up. Wake the hell up. When you sit here crying and whining about a black job and said what Donald Trump said, Trump was right. Yes, those jobs are going to go bye-bye to you. Guess who's getting them? People ain't even supposed to be here. They're getting them because they'll work for less. They'll work for less. Really don't have to give them medical. Don't have to give them benefits. Just put them out there on a job. Think about it, idiots.
What about the people that actually lined up to go through the rooms? You know, I want to become a citizen, so I take the courses.
The right
way. See, nobody's checking. They've got an outbreak of hepatitis. They got an outbreak of measles. HIV is ramped up. They've got all kinds of things. They've got problems
all that's reported.
Strains of tuberculosis.
Yep. All of this, what he's saying, has been reported. Y'all paying attention and hearing the news. We know this. We've seen this. This is all stuff that has been reported here that's been an outbreak of and an uptick in. And some of the stuff that we haven't seen a big seen around in how many years? Okay. When's the last time you've seen a measles outbreak in this country? All of a sudden, here in the past recent of 3 years, oh, damn, we got a measles outbreak in this country. Gee, I wonder where that's coming from.
That have no cure. So people are, before they come down with it, you have to put them on prophylactics for the rest of their life so they don't get a fatal illness that nobody can cure. So nobody is running the medical test. Nobody is checking to see what penitentiary they got out of. And something that is pretty real is a movie. You remember Al Pacino in Scarface? They dumped all their penitentiaries and they're over here. You got all of these Latino gangs that have now infiltrated.
That's right. Remember that report just come out early part of this year talking about how Venezuela's gang violent crimes have gone down 67%. Gee. And then ours went up where? Here in New York, Chicago. I mean, they're just showing up all of a sudden. It's like, dude, out in L.A., it's like, what the hell's up with these Venezuelan gangs showing up now?
You've got Ukraine. You've got Gaza. You've got people that hate the fact that they don't have technology to shoot down a B-1B bomber. So what do? They just walk across the damn border. Nobody's checking them. Somebody is giving them free transportation without even vetting their luggage. And in the luggage, they have military-grade explosives, which over the last several years, I'm sure they put in various building structures, hospitals, subways, and everything else. And on command, they flip the switch, and 911 looks like a Boy Scout meeting. So what are you going to do about these things? Nobody's checking. You have a situation right now that has to be taken into context. Just about every major seaport is using these container removal cranes, these giant gantry cranes. Mm-hmm. They're made in the People's Republic of China. Nobody checked them, and now they went back and did, and there seem to be some things built into them that they can't remove. Don't know what the function is, but they appear to be communication devices. What the hell are those? You know, so you want to shoot down a B-1 bomber 56 miles from the southern border point where there is a huge illegal crossing. There is a U.S. Air Force base where 24 B-1 bombers stage out of. You can just surround a damn base with some RPGs and take a few of them out. We don't have but 24 of them that are operational, and some other was in long-term storage because we can't afford to operate the damn things. What are you supposed to do? That was your job. Did you do it?
Nope.
Did you handle it? No.
Nope.
So, you know, they've got this thing where sometimes they promote people up. You know, you fail at a job, but you got a rep, so they can't get rid of you, so they promote you. Like, for example, Halsey, Admiral Halsey. Bull Halsey, always charged off, was aggressive. Great in World War II, the first part of it. But there was a thing in the Philippines, well, not Philippines, Leyte Gulf. It was a disaster. The Japanese laid a decoy force out. He fell for the trap, took off with all of the warships, left the beaches totally unguarded, told nobody, and he should have been court-martialed. But because of his fame, they couldn't, so they wound up promoting him to five-star admiral instead of court-martialing him and canceling him. So, I mean, they do this kind of thing. So it's not unusual. But I'm just saying, hey, if you're going to bring somebody in, bring in somebody that knows what the hell they're doing.
And that's the crap, man, right there. Here of what, a week ago? Maybe now coming up on 2 weeks, she was never the border czar. You know, Kamala was never the border czar. No damn good and well, the video sitting out there with Biden putting her in charge of the southern border and the activity of what's going on down there to basically handle that, report back to him and back to the administration and say, hey, this is what's going on. We need this, 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 and this done. Did she do that? One damn job. One job. That's all she had. The only assignment she had. She went to it one damn time. And then to do a damn video op at a section of the border where nobody's crossing there at all. Basically a dead zone. Okay. She had one job. Did she do it? He's right. Did she do it? No. This woman is incompetent and incapable of running this country. She has no foreign diplomacy as far as handling diplomatic leaders. And if you think already we're a laughing stock because of Dementia Joe, okay, for the past four years, they knew it. They knew what was coming up, man, when this dude got in. You think it's a laughing joke now? This woman gets in, dude. She's going to get steamrolled. Steamrolled. Watch what I say. She gets in. Mark my words. You can mark this video right now. 43 minutes in what I'm saying right now. She is going back at about 42. She's going to get steamrolled. And they know it. They over there licking the chops right now. China, Russia, North Korea, Iran, they licking the chops praying this woman gets in. Praying that this woman gets into power. Then you think, this shit's going to get turned up. Big time.
Meanwhile, she had a little rally in Georgia. I think 86 people showed up. That was supposed to be interesting. And she had the nerve to call Vance unpatriotic. Okay. And he came back on her big time. He said, simplify, yeah, to serve, loyalty. I was in the Marine Corps. Over in the sand pile.
Yep.
And Trump took a bullet. What the hell have you done?
Exactly.
You know, and you want to call somebody out on the subject. See, it's hypocrisy. But you see, I did this because I did what I did, and that's what I did, which is because that's why I did it. What the hell did you just say? Do you realize what you said? Do you know?
No, no. Oh, man, I swear, dude. Judge Joe Brown, he is something else, man. Is more. This interview is long, and I know I stretched it out with my commentary on this. I had thought about doing this live. Guys, if you don't get a chance to watch it, just listen. That's it. You can put it in the background, listen to it, and check it out if you get back to it. I'm going to put a link in the descriptions for this video here. But, man, I mean, he breaks it down about this woman. And like I said, it's been a thing that has bugged me so much about this lady. One, I can't stand her, all right? She just irritates me big time. She irritates me. Not as bad as Hillary Clinton, because that's a whole nother level of annoyance that I have for that woman. I got absolute disdained dislike to the core of my being. I cannot stand that woman. So, God, I can't stand Hillary. Never liked her, ever. Okay. And still don't, and actually like her even less today. So, anyway, guys, check out the video. Let me know what you think here. Don't forget to hit that like button, man. Like I said, I know it was long, going 46 minutes in on this, but if you didn't see this, because the interview, what he ran, just this section was, this second here was about almost 30 minutes. So, what about 16 minutes or so talking in on this video. Like I said, just listen to it in the background, man. It's a good listen. It's a good listen. If you get a chance to watch it, watch it. There's more to it here coming from the Art of Dialogue. This is a nice setup you guys did here with this interview with him. And the man tells it straight. Judge Joe Brown tells it straight to the knowledge that he has of everything. He's not going to BS you, period, at all. And I've never seen this man pull a punch, and I've never seen him BS anything. He tells it straight, just like it is. He's still to this day. Years ago on the show, back in the day, like I said, he used to make me laugh, man. He's had me rolling. Dude, he was raw. He was raw dog on him. I loved it. And even now, so, man. Anyway, guys, like I said, just check it out. Don't forget to hit that like button. You know, the whole yada yada, subscribe, everything else. Share this, dude. Share this content, seriously. Either go to the link, share my video. I appreciate you so much. If you do, seriously, thank you. I'll be back again here on another one here. So you guys stay safe, and I'll see you on the next one.